Hey everyone, how's it going? Welcome back to Let's Play Dark Souls 3. Our next area that we're going to be hitting is the Cathedral of the Deep, which opened up after beating the Crystal Sages in the Crucifixion Woods. I think a lot of people do the Cathedral before Farron Keep, but I wanted to take care of the Abyss Watchers for fashion purposes. Now rocking Gunder's helm with Artorias' chest piece. Looking good. Right away, as you come here, there are two crystal lizards. One of which you can get with a plunging attack, the other is right around the corner after a drop. So we've taken an all-around strange path through the game up to this point, but it's gonna kind of straighten out a little bit from here. There are a couple of branches yet to come. I think the normal path goes something like Yudex, Gunder, Vort, Greatwood, Sages, and then the Cathedral, and then the Abyss Watchers. And then, I think most people tend to do Osiris, Dancer, and Champion Gunder as like their 12th, 13th, and 14th bosses to give you an idea of how far off the beaten path we got. Let me finish him quick before we have to fight 2-on-1. This is good. Because we took that route, I got a bunch of souls from late game levels, so I'm a little bit over leveled going into the Cathedral. The boss of this area is trivial no matter what level you fight him at, so I'm not too worried about that. But I don't want to completely overpower everything that we come up against, so I am going to stop leveling for a little while, and in a couple of areas from now, the game should start to catch up with me. And things will level out. So I also have a new weapon for this area that I'm going to be using a bunch, along with my other usual suspects. Oh man, it sailed right over. My hitboxes are as precise as ever. Feels so good when you watch that. Oop, got me against the corner a little bit. Fuck. It's okay. Nope. Just judge the range. You only need one more though. The Herald gear. The Herald gear is what the... I think it's just the Herald class starts out with. Steel armor with a pure white cape. Signature of the Herald's the Way of the White. Yeah. Been a while since we heard about the Way of the White. Herald was almost the class I started out with. But I just wanted to start with that S-stock. We'll just rest up real quick, get our Estus back up to full. And right here, you can see a drop down. There are the Paladin's Ashes at the end of this dead end. There's also an NPC, which if you proceed up the stairs towards the Cathedral, you get sandwiched between him and another NPC. Ooh. And this moveset, I know I gushed over it before, but fuck, this is one of my favorite weapons. I want to get that parry. You can always count on predictable aggression to get good parries in. I always find myself, yeah, like that. Parries I've always had a really hard time doing on reaction, but whenever you can anticipate a parry, it's very, very easy. Which is why aggression is such a double-edged sword. Umbral ash of a worn-out paladin who saw the Cathedral of the Deep. With this, the shrine handmaid will prepare new items, blah blah blah. Paladin paid quite a price for his headstrong justice. And it looks like the hand in the icon is clutching a Lloyd's talisman. Lloyd being Allfather Lloyd, the uncle to Lord Gwyn, and the head of the Way of the White. Although I think there are a couple of descriptions of Lloyd in this one. That mention him being deposed or disgraced or something like that. Which may or may not be apocryphal. Or it might just retroactively make all of the material about Lloyd in Dark Souls 1 apocryphal. Also, the Lloyd's talismans, I should say, are, they're still in the game. They're not called Lloyd's Talismans anymore. They're called, Undead Hunter Charms now. Oh, let's... I thought there was a different item up here. Oh. Let's do this. Run, jump, plunge! Oh, yeah. And this is the... Not the Pyromancer starting glass. I think the Bandit starting glass from Dark Souls 1, including the Spider Shield. Which is that heavily poison-resistant shield from DS1. And 2, I think. Oh. He buffed himself twice. Oh, feels so good. I don't get to do enough parrying when I LP these games, because it takes a little bit more focus than I can actually divert from commentary. But when you do get a chance, so good. The fucking moveset on this Baron Greatsword is the best. Let's mess with the Chaos Blade a little bit too, since I haven't actually tried out any katana weapons yet. The Chaos Blade is the katana which drains your health as you strike with it. Ooh! Lana... Oh, it reminds me of that part right before you get into Hemwick proper. With all of the hunters and the dogs. Just firing at you from all sides. There's one more dog I miss? Unless it's the one up ahead. I couldn't have triggered him. Oh no, hey! Hello? I didn't even realize there was one more dog left. Hopefully I don't get prodded in the side with an arrow. Or a bolt. Holy shit. So what I think I'm gonna do is I'm gonna take the left path around after I get this dog on. Yeah. This left trench. That way I'm safe from everything firing at me. And I can kind of trigger this dog from over here. Yeah! Hit me right out of the leap attack. Is that lack of poise? Underneath my status bar, you can occasionally see, well, when I'm in combat. I have the UI set to disappear when I'm out of combat now. There are a bunch of icons for buffs and debuffs. There is one that kind of looks like the Calamity Ring icon you get from Calamite in Dark Souls 1 in the DLC. The Calamity Ring is the one that increases the damage that you take. Caught up with me. That's the icon for the Prisoner's Chain from Yonder Soul. Or rather, it's the icon for anything that lowers your absorption. So the Clutch Rings will also put that icon on you, that debuff icon. As will a certain ring we'll be getting in the next area from the Catacombs. So you're taking more damage, but in exchange, the Prisoner's Chain is actually really, really good. It adds 5 Vitality, 5 Endurance, and 5 Vigor. But it makes you take much more damage. But there are two ways that damage is mitigated in Dark Souls 3. Through Absorption and through Defense. Both of those are calculated into the damage reduction formula. Absorption is what you get through armor and rings, defense is what you get through stats. There's been a little bit back and forth about the exact way that the damage reduction is calculated in this game, so... I won't comment on the nitty-gritty of that just yet, but suffice it to say, the chain reduces your absorption by, I think, 10%, but it gives you, again, 15 stats between Vigor, Endurance, and Vitality. So that's more health, more stamina, and more physical defense that you're getting from the Vitality, plus the equipment load. It's so worth it for that little penalty. That 10% absorption penalty. The prisoner's chain is actually really good. Now the zombies in this here graveyard will respawn indefinitely. They aren't like the skeletons with the necromancers from the catacombs in DS1. Oh, and I think they vomit leeches onto you. Leeches which will constantly build your bleed up, kind of like in a manner similar to Frenzy. Plus, they just gross you out. Hopefully I've taken... Nope, I haven't. This upper part of the cemetery can be a little bit confusing and circuitous. There are a couple of things that I want to make sure that I grab before continuing on. Getting through the cemetery is just a straight line through here and not getting stuck on all of the zombies. But there are a few things that are hidden around, which I'm trying to find. And they just body block you at every angle. Ooh! These guys. Yep. I'm gonna try to bait them out a little bit. And the Faerun Greatsword is actually gonna do work, especially in these slightly more open areas where the sword's not gonna clang off against the gravestone. But it can just hit everything in this giant AoE. You guys. Oh, it didn't, there it did. For the first time, it didn't glance off. That's actually what makes the cemetery kind of dangerous, is just the sheer volume of enemies. They can prevent you from running away sometimes. And that's a big ambush. Just like a dozen zombies spawn in. Okay, so that bridge is the path forward. Make sure you get out of the way. Did they even drop souls? Oh yeah, they drop like 22 per. Bait you out a little bit. These guys are some of the zombies that can cause really massive bleed buildup. That's gonna whip, isn't it? Yeah, but even when it does whip, if they're just barely on the edge, they still get knocked back a little bit by the shockwave. I was saying before about the testing that's going on the damage reduction formula. There's also some questionable testing on that's been done on the Chloranthi ring. That shows it might be pretty weak right now, so I don't know if it's worth sticking around as I get more decent rings later on, but I don't know that the verdict is in on that yet. And because we're near another white birch, the giant from the undead settlement, yeah, he's still sniping away with those cottage-sized arrows. Still sniping away. You can see where they're coming from. Aww. This one ain't get a good look. Yeah, so the giant's tower is still visible from here. And because he has line of sight on all of this and we befriended him, he's still taking things out for us. Angle on it. I know it's hard to see from over here. But on this gravestone, there's another undead bone shard. Second time we found an undead bone shard near the white birch from which the giant was firing arrows off. Hmm. Oh, yeah, I can just come up these stairs, right? To the left, or behind us now, is where we would go to progress. There's a little optional path down this way that starts off with the Curse Ward Great Shield. The Curse Ward Great Shield, you might recognize as the Pursuer's Great Shield. Rachel given to those who resisted the curse long ago, far too heavy for an ordinary person, perhaps it signifies the foolishness of resisting the curse, and yet those who bear the weight of the shield will not find its protections against curses wanting. Yep, it's the Pursuer's Great Shield. The Pursuer's Great Shield. Ooh, Schmeagol. He has some sort of abnormal growth coming out of his back, much like the pus of man. Which, by the way, if you haven't figured it out by now, the shells that the pilgrims are wearing chained to their backs, that appears to be some kind of protection against that, against the writhing, oozing black mass that we've seen growing out of the pus of man and Yudex Gunder. I want these guys to inflict a little bit of bleed on me. Normally they do that whenever they hit you. Oh no, it's just going away right away. I'm giving him a chance because I want to show something off. No? Okay. Maybe it's the ones later on? Am I not remembering this right? Okay, you. Oh, and he does a little poke with the dagger. Ah. This is a great weapon. I keep trying to do that, but for some reason, I can't do the jumping attack out of a run with this sword. It's just coming out as the normal R2. What is this? The Saint Tree Bellvine? Is that a catalyst? Sacred chime for casting miracles of the gods. A bellvine cut from a small saint tree that has been meticulously tended to. Saint Tree Bellvines are customary in the far north and allow for faster casting than ordinary sacred chimes. Close enough, it was a chime. Oh, hello. No bleed, no bleed. Yeah, they added this thing in Dark Souls 3 where you can do a jumping attack out of a running R2 now. Like, you run and you hit R2 and you do the jumping attack automatically, but that doesn't seem to be working with the Farron Greatsword for me. Which is why for a second I thought that it didn't have a jumping attack, which would have been bizarre, but no, it does. Be a weird weapon-specific oversight. Don't flank off the wall, please. Oh, wait, no, there is a second one. This one is meant to lead you into a trap. Whenever you see all these crystals around, you kind of know what's coming. One of these giant crystal lizards. But they take so long to wake up that you aren't in that much danger of getting caught by it while you're chasing the small crystal lizard. And rip. Yeah, figures. Oh, get back here. I don't like when they go into these valleys. Because they are large enough that they will freak the camera out. Like, tight spaces and big enemies still have not been fixed as far as the camera problems they cause. Still really bad. Oh! Yeah, let me back up so I don't keep getting caught by shit. Does it? One Titanite scale. Just one. I think we were getting two apiece from the ones in the Untended Graves. Is this an ambush through here? Oh no, it's just the one leech monster. Whole body made up of leeches. the mini leechmonger. The leechmonger dog. What is... Oh, wait a minute. Hold on. I think I see. Hit me. Yeah, even if I block it, they still cover me in leeches. I see what was going on. So you see the bleed constantly building up. That's because my body is covered in all of these leeches. But as soon as I pull the torch out, they're all going to go away. And the bleed stops building up. So while you're covered in leeches, it builds up indefinitely and it's like frenzy. And I didn't know about the torch trick my first time through, so I was just constantly getting bled out. And then it would just start building up right away again. I couldn't get the leeches off me. I had no idea how on the first playthrough. So what I did was I just said, fuck it. I'll go through here and just waste all of my Estus. I'll just deal with it. It is a much simpler solution to that. What I was having a hard time with before was because the torch was on my back, unlit. I couldn't understand why I wasn't getting the constant buildup of bleed from the leeches. It doesn't make any sense that they are afraid to take some bites out of you while the torch is put away on your back. But I guess that's the case. Might be better for me to just... What is that the... Oh no, I know what this is. Yeah, might be better for me in just Homeward Bone. Because I am a tad bit... Not lost, like I know pretty well where I am. I just can't remember what the quickest way back up to where I want to go is. I know there was the part with the ladder, but I can't remember where exactly I kicked the ladder down from. which I kind of feel stupid about, but hey, I did find something that I almost missed. A single shitty Titanite shard, which I can buy for like 800 souls a pop. yeah, you know what? I am gonna go back to the bonfire. Oh wait, I hit the shrine bonfire. Whoops. So, since we have some loading times to kill, I was on the topic about, like, defense testing and the Chloranthi ring and the prisoner's chain earlier. There's something else I brought up last time that if you're new to a Souls game, it might not make sense to you. I was talking about how poise doesn't work anymore. And, poise is a secondary stat that you get through your armor, usually. And the way it typically works is the heavier the armor, the more poise it has. And what poise is supposed to do is stop you from getting interrupted mid-attack. As is currently, you can get stunned out of attacking by a dagger even if you're wearing like full hovels, which is typically the most poise-heavy armor set in the game. It's completely broken. For reasons that nobody quite understands. It seems to work for things like the Iron Flesh Pyromancy or certain weapon arts like the Dark Swords weapon art, but not on actual armor itself. Oh wow, those crows leaving their feathers behind. This is this really nice painterly effect. It doesn't quite mesh with the rest of the game, but it's nice. Yeah, for some reason, poise just doesn't seem to work anymore. Alright, we still have the Grave Warden. So I'm kind of bummed that the Black Knight Shield itself does not have a parry, but if you are using a weapon that happens to have a parry, yeah, you can still parry with the Black Knight Shield. Or rather, with the Black Knight Shield equipped. Because what the Black Knight Shield's weapon art is that it just allows you to use the weapon art of whatever weapon that you're one-handing. Normally, you have to be two-handing it. And this big old cathedral door not open from this side yet. It's going to provide a nice big shortcut later on. Ugh, man. This big black knight shield on my back. Like, you could see the sword clipping through it so hard. Someone just threw a Lloyd's talisman. Was it you? Yeah. A shit ambush. Guy in the tower. It's raining down fiery crossbow bolts. Oh, there's you too. Oh, he could get kind of dangerous. The explosion could knock me off the roof. Yeah. If he spawned in while I was distracted fighting the rest of the enemies, that would have been a really good ambush. I might have just panicked and rolled myself off the roof before he had a chance to knock me off. The clipping is the worst it has ever been. It's so bad. They're really digging the Lloyd's talismans. Oh, no. That's okay. He threw himself off the roof, off the buttress. Chill, my dude. Oh, the explosion radius isn't all that big. Lucky. Man, we hear some more of these. Tiny little thralls. Always good for an ambush. Yep, hey. Lamberge one. Jesus Christ! There are a lot of you. And there's still the one back there just chilling with, like, no health. With a magic pixel. Come here, buddy. Go! You did it! You died! Ah. And... oh! Hello! I was wondering where this one went. Like, what an MVP. What an MVP that one was. He lasted the longest and did the most damage with the least amount of health. Oh, no. Like, there. Poise didn't matter for shit. Still just got hit out of the mid-swing. And yet, like, Iron Flesh still works, so there's something about poise that's still working, just not on armor. Really, really strange. I think Namco on Twitter has acknowledged that there's some kind of problem with it that they're looking into. So hopefully that'll be patched eventually. Love the crossbows in this. The crossbowmen need to chill. Thank you. Finally taking that swing. The only thing I hate about the Faron Greatsword is how it clips through the Black Knight shield. I don't know whether to blame the shield or the sword, or just blame from. Fuck, the clipping is bad. Clipping in poise. Oh! Like, all the enemies are running straight off the roof today. This could go kind of nasty. Oh, yeah. Pretty sure that her spike mace sailed over me twice. I need to get away from that, though. The spell that she's casting, I think, is Gnaw, which is a bleed spell. Good job, man. You did it. You did it. This spot up on the balcony sucks to fight the evangelists. The evangelists were women who set out from the church to spread the religion of the Cathedral out to the rest of Lothric and convince them to send their sacrifices here for Aldrich. And Aldrich... I think I've said this before, but also known as the saint of the deep. He's the saint and founder of the Cathedral of the Deep's religion. The deep derives its name from something very specific to Aldrich, but it shares a lot of similarities with the abyss. And the important thing is that it seems like the deep and the abyss coexist, but are somehow separate. I think it's possible that it could just be Koth behind the scenes, spinning the abyss as something more pure. Kind of like rebranding it, because the Dark Wraiths were kind of a fringe group. But if he spins the Age of Dark and the Abyss is the deep, this profound, consecrated place worshipped by some huge religion in Lothric, maybe it makes it all more appealing. Like he's trying to establish the Abyss as more of an organized, sacrosanct religion and not just some creepy ass cult full of dark wraiths. That's total conjecture though. We are gonna have to wait to settle some really big questions about the deep though. In the cathedral, we tend to get a lot more info about like the hierarchy of the religion. There's Aldrich, the figurehead and the founder. There's the pontiff, Sullivan. Who I used to call Sylvain. I guess it was just transposing where the Y was in the name. I like Sylvain better. Sullivan. There's the pontiff. Who we've read a lot about up till now. And then there are the deacons. Who we learn more about as we go deeper into the cathedral. That you don't backstab me. And then there should be a Grey Warden up here. The problem is, I think there are actually two Grey Wardens. Yeah, okay, good. This is exactly what I wanted. Wanted to trigger one before the other can join in on the fun. That was my backstab. And I took my sweet time. I was fishing for either a window to parry her or to get a backstab in. And that wasn't the wisest choice. And enemies don't have shit for poise either. Oh, this is not good though. Two Grave Wardens is so dangerous to fight. They break your guard really quickly. They bleed on you really quickly. It's a big pain. Nope. It's not good either. Okay, that's one. Now it's just a one-on-one. Only I could have gotten that earlier. And that's probably one of the more dangerous parts of the outside of the cathedral, is the dual Grey Wardens. Are they two of the exploders? Let me see if I can hide behind this out of line of sight and ambush them. That explosion hurts like shit, man. Yeah, that's exactly who you are. Love the L1 on the Faron Greatsword. Okay, you. Yeah. You were gonna come to life anyway. And then this big teal door. This is the first time that we're actually gonna be able to enter the cathedral proper. But not just yet. There was something right in plain sight to pick up. Go, speed racer. Oh, no! Should've kept an eye out on that left corner. he whipped just barely because of the angle that the second L1 took me at. Oh, I wish the explosion could hurt them. Ember. Totally worth that ambush. There's a really, really good ambush later on in one of the later areas that is also just for an ember. Like, you see an item in plain sight and you get ambushed from so many angles for it. You're not actually worth killing. That one is just there to tell you that there are blobs around. And if you've played... that's Corrosive Mist. Which is confusing because it looks like the Corrosive Mist from 2. I don't think there's any kind of Corrosive Mist like that in DS3. I think there is still an Acid Cloud, but I don't think there are any traps like that. What was I saying? The blob enemy. They show you there is one single blob enemy on the floor to telegraph to you that there are these enemies in here. And you know why that's significant if you play Dark Souls 1, because in Dark Souls 1, those blobs fell onto your head from the ceiling and it counted as a grab attack that did a whole bunch of damage. So it's just kind of giving you a little warning sign to say, hey, these enemies are here. You might want to start watching the ceilings from now on. And we're going to have to start doing that now. Also, we see, once again, the broken bridge. We went up to Inferon Keep. And we unlock our first shortcut back to this bonfire. This particular bonfire has really good shortcut porn. There's really only this one bonfire for most of the level. And that's gonna do it for now. We'll finish up the cathedral next time. Thanks for watching, everyone. Take it easy. Have a good one.